me and my friends on my block in inner city Brooklyn, somebody would beatbox and I would pretend to sing in an opera style when I was like 16, 17 years old, never having seen an opera or heard an opera. And everyone was like, "Oh my God, did you hear that? She can sing opera."
My name is Gregory Hopkins, and I am the artistic director for Harlem Opera Theater. The mission of Harlem Opera is to present the wonderful world of classical vocal music to an underserved community, that is here, the community of Harlem, and to offer opportunities to underserved artists, that is the artists of Harlem, and to bring the two of them together. The underserved community, the underserved artists, to present great art to anyone that will hear us. Every year, Harlem Opera Theater sponsors a competition for emerging singers. We require that those singers do operatic literature from the standard operatic repertoire in the original keys. Now, mind you, all professionals don't sing live in their performances in the original keys, but we require that singers present their arias in the original keys, in the original language, because we want to prepare them to compete in the real world. A lot of what comes into play with singers in competitions is nerves, because unlike performing, in competitions, most judges are looking for a reason to eliminate you. Whereas when you're performing, the energy is that people want to be entertained. So we try to drive singers through that process by putting them in situations that they can handle so that they will be able to handle the next level of pressure.
Definitely very pleased, for sure, and very proud to be a part of this really significant competition. The competition was definitely the right moment and propelled me into finding an agent right after the competition.
I was always told that my voice type would take a while to develop. And so finally, when I did place in the competition, but not only place, when I won, I was just really, really surprised. And I felt like there was hope, you know, because I had been trying so hard. Just voice and voice technique, my critiques, I just didn't know certain things. I think it's clear that I knew what I was talking about, which is very, very important to me. And even as I was listening to the words, I was like, yeah, I'm saying this in a way where it's clear I know what I'm saying, which is, I never want to step on stage and have it be meaningless. So for me, before every competition that I've done really well at, I've been reciting the English translation to myself backstage incessantly before going on. Understanding of the culture that it takes us much longer to get. I got invited to do a program in Switzerland, and I met a German opera singer, and she was a friend of mine, and she was just explaining to me a jewelry box that full of like some jewelry that she had, and she was explaining to me the history of her jewelry, and I realized her life embodied basically what opera was about, that it was her culture and her experience. And the more I've done opera, the more I realize there's partially what we try to do here in the States when we study is partially we're trying to capture European culture. And it's really hard to do that because we aren't raised, Americans are just very different. And I personally, I'm, you know, the furthest from, I feel so far from European culture. My parents are Haitian, they're from Haiti, and it's just so, the culture is very different. I was raised in Brooklyn, very culturally different. Inner city Brooklyn, very culturally different. I train martial arts. Like, when I'm not doing opera, I'm like choking people and trying to break their arms. It's just sort of like everything about me is so different.
African Americans in classical music sounds like it's something that is a rather new phenomenon.
but in actuality, there is a history line. If we look back into the late part of the 19th century, we have singers like the one they called the Black Patty, Ciceretta Jones, who had tremendous career, but never had the opportunity to appear in an actual opera because of the prejudices. Since then, there have been countless African Americans who have had concert career. We think of names like Darian Anderson, who turned out to be the first African American to actually debut in the Metropolitan Opera. We have Dorothy Maynard, who was part of what they called the African American Quartet. She founded the Harlem School of the Arts. Great tenor, Roland Hayes, who did numerous concerts, many by popular demand, at Carnegie Hall. And Paul Robeson, who used his operatic voice in order to present political ideologies with a better way of doing things. He used his singing to help unions. He used his singing to organize workers. He used his voice to bless and motivate the common people.
Oh, how proud our choir.
So down through the ages, there has been a timeline for African American singers, but the color line in opera did not break until Darian Anderson at the Metropolitan Opera. I worked with one of my great mentors, Sylvia Lee, who poured so much into my life as a coach, as a mother figure, and as a friend. Mrs. Lee, who was the first African-American vocal coach at the Metropolitan Opera, was able to pass because of very fair skin and straight hair. But Sylvia Lee owned up to her African-Americanism by making her first line granddaughter of slaves, and her mother refusing to sing in the Metropolitan Opera if she could not be known for her African roots.
I am speaking from a Fisk family to which I never belonged because I am the granddaughter of a slave. I got to know my grandfather, who was born this slave and who came at the end of the war to Nashville from Kentucky, the Kentucky plantation, Oldham. But he decided he didn't want to keep that dumb spelling, he said. He would call it O-L-D-E-N. So he came up to Fisk and met my grandmother, who was fortunate because her father was the founder of the Baptist Church Still Standing, 1853. She was the daughter of the minister. She was a Jubilee singer, one of the first. She married this George Olden, and then they had my father, who was a theologue. He was studying for the ministry, but he belonged to this quartet, the Fisk Quartet people. If you were a Fisk Quartet person, you couldn't just get up and throw a few spirituals around. Every one of those members of the quartet had also to study lieder, chanson, canzone. They had to study voice technique. They had to know piano, and they had to read. So they had to add to what they had as a curriculum and get up and perform classics. And after we had gotten through with There is a Balm in Gilead, I'm sure that a lot of you know that, one of the folks walked up and said, you know, this sounds so, it has no African sound to me. It seems quite like Schubert. And so I said, well, that would naturally happen if the masters loved music and had to have it. They had live music only. And they would find the most talented of the slaves and train them as well as they could and have them to entertain so that they would go around and hear other music and they'd hear the classics. And that's why we're coming closer together. Many a spiritual has an 18th, 19th century patina that goes through it.
My dad's an attorney, and he asks me all the time, why didn't you go to law school? And, you know, my challenge has been trying to stay afloat in this career and make it make sense to your family, because I will say, coming from a black and brown household sometimes, you know, like, they don't fully understand the ropes of opera in general, you know? And my grandmother, her sweetheart, she's like, you just need to meet Tyler Perry. And your whole life is gonna change. My dear goes to the opera, that's the thing.
Most African-American singers will be required to have to sing opera and music that touches on the African-American vernacular. If any of you have seen Three Mo Tenors, you see how those tenors negotiate classical music, pop, blues, gospel, and everything. And that's one of the things that makes African-American singers special and unique. They don't require most Caucasian singers to be great singers of Mariah Carey material, although some of them do it. But that is sort of a prerequisite for African-American singers.
It means that something about me that I can't control will always be targeted by the people that are looking at me. So I carry that with me through my entire life. But how it appears on stage, it means that I have a very interesting story to tell that sometimes will not get told because people try to fit me. People will cast me despite the fact that I'm black. So to me, that means they will put me in really traditional productions. They won't really use my interesting, unique cultural experience to bring to the story that they're trying to tell. They'll instead ask the audience to suspend their disbelief as they watch a black lady carry the story. It's just kind of a lack of imagination. It also means that I'm walking into situations where people always expect me to not be good. So I'll have to prove myself all the time. And I'm pretty good at stepping up to the challenge, so I'm not usually worried about that, but it is exhausting. So I get tired a lot.
There have been struggles, for sure. But I think that is part of the beauty of it. Because of all of the struggles from the outside, for me, it creates more beauty within myself. And I think that's what people connect with. I transfer that and I try to learn from each situation.
Taught to the black and brown community. A lot of black and brown children that I teach, when I sing to them, they laugh because they think it's funny. But they don't think it's funny because they're laughing at me. They're more so surprised. And they don't know that they can like it. So that's the problem area right there. So that is a generational challenge. I feel like I would have made it when I can be that opera singer who changes the face of opera for black people and for young people. I want, you know, there's a wave of millennials, you know, and I want millennials, especially, you know, millennials of color, to flood opera houses, you know, and right now there's a following, you know, of black millennials who follow opera. But I want our black children in schools to don't laugh at opera because they don't know how to take it. I want it to be common in all of our households. I want it to be taught to children. And I, you know, that's my initiative, so.
I think that the taste of the classical music and the operatic going, the opera going community has shifted. People are now interested in seeing something that is new, something that is different, something that is not the status quo. And in light of our political climate, in light of our health climate, in light of our racial climate, people are interested in art and in opera that addresses issues. Now more than ever, there is a voice for African American artists to stand up and speak about what it means to be an African American. Music is being written that challenges those ideas and puts the issues in front of people so that people have to confront the racial prejudice, the discrimination, the underserved status that minorities have, not just African Americans. So I look at that as a wonderful springboard for opportunity for us as soon as we can get out of this current climate.
I'm not afraid.
it only shows that we are closer and closer if we all will work very, very diligently. I know from the fact that you're here, your presence attests to the fact that you believe in justice and one world. I hope you keep persevering and going into the far corners of this globe, selling it to other people, because we are one family. We all belong to one God, no matter what you call it. And as such, we should keep in touch with each other through classics and folk music.